Yeah, I wouldn't mind trying. Actually, I don't work on anything too big anymore. Just get too old. Well, R.L. Drake started in 1942. I had 43 up there, but I saw a paper from the collection that I have from Milt Sullivan. By the way, I do have the actual files in my car, if you actually want to see them. You gotta be careful because some of those papers are pretty old. I can bring them if you guys want to see them. So it is actually 1942. They made a lot of filters. Bob Drake, his prior history is on the in a book, the Drake called The Family Affair book, written by John Lothmiller, which he sold the rights to Universal Radio. So if you want to get a good book for reading, I don't know how many have that book. It's really very, very, very good. I believe I have one with me here. You don't have one, Nick? I can give you one. If I have it, you can have it. Oh, that's great. Yeah. Anyway, they made filters, jamming. In fact, they made a jamming device to help the tanks in the North African region, and they really got known for that. And they also made a three-tube receiver. You'll see it here a little bit later, which I didn't know about either, and it's in their museum. And that museum was put together by Bill Frost and a number of employees for Drake at the end, after Blunder Tongue bought Drake. Back, how has it been, 5 years, 6 years now? It's been a while. And it's at the VOA, Voice of America there in Ohio. Here's Bob Drake. That's the only picture I could find of him from the 70s. He died in 1975. And I don't know quite the age, but that was his call, WHCYE. And so here's some of the filters, how well that looks. You can see this one in particular was the tank filter. A couple of them here. Those are the actual filters. There is a 1951 catalog online. If you go to wb4hfn.com and look under Sindri Thorpe's link, you can actually see more pictures, a 1951 catalog of some of the stuff. There's a three-tube receiver right there. The three-tube receiver. And that looks familiar, Bob, hey? I don't know if they had anything, apparently they must have had something to do with that. I don't know the history there. 1946, after the big one, Bob Drake needed help growing the company. And Milt Sullivan was hired from the University of Cincinnati as a co-op student. Drake had a great co-op program. And here's Milt Sullivan, senior years, 1946 to 1983. 37 years service, plus 4 years of consulting for Drake. After the satellite business, he did a lot of satellite calculations. Some of that stuff's in those files. Azimuth and all that stuff, because they made dishes. They made big dishes. We're talking the big stuff from way back. And he started his job at 86 cents an hour. And the story behind that was, Bob Drake said, well, how much should I pay you? And he says, well, how about 86 cents an hour? And he didn't figure taxes, Social Security, or any of that other stuff. And Bob Drake knew that. But, he says, you want 86 cents an hour? That's exactly what you're going to get. And that's the actual pay that he got. That actually is in the file here, 86 cents. Oh, a little story about that. I'll just sideline a little bit. And I read this in some notes that his wife had told John Lothmiller, because John was going to write another book about Drake, subsequent to the first book. And it was Bob... And Milt had a great relationship. They got along great, but he didn't want to pay him. So I'll give you a promotion. I'll make you chief engineer. How's that sound? He said, yeah, but where's the money? We'll make you chief. And that was it. There was no talk after that. We got disgruntled and left for Collins Radio. Collins grabbed him up. And then Art, and this is after he sold the house that he bought from Bob Drake, in a farm and everything, kind of like this, not as many acres. And Bob says, well, how could you leave me like this? Well, you're not going to pay me. He says, they're going to pay me twice of a trip. I'll match it. He says, no, that's okay. And he already went to Collins. We're going to work for Art Collins, because Collins knew about Milt Sullivan. And he said, I'll double it what he's going to pay him. He says, well, in that case, maybe I'll come back. And he came back. So he went back to work for Drake. So that's just a little sideline. Isn't that something? And there was never any question about pay after that. There was always enough money coming in. They continue to make chokes, RF filters, Q multipliers, and foam patches, and power transformers. This I didn't know. I found that out in my catalog. Didn't realize that. Bill Frost didn't tell me that either. But they made a lot of accessory items. These are some of them, as you probably recognize, the filters, And here's a crude 300. That's one of the early filters from right after the war, when television was just starting out. And of course, a Q multiplier and foam patch. And they made a lot of power supplies for ERT-13s. They made a lot of parts for Delco, GM. Delco, didn't know that. That's just recently doing a little more research. And Milton came up with a Bob Drake, they came up with a extremely stable receiver, looked like a bread box. The reason for the bread box was, if you look at this receiver, this transmitter, let's call this a receiver, and most of the receivers are about this high. They thought if they put a receiver up against it, about this wide, and that high, and that deep, the guys might like it. And make a long story short, they approached National Helicopters, Cameron, I don't know which order that was, but at least those three, and I think maybe one or two others. And they all declined. We thought, well, you're working up the wrong storm. Big and heavy is the way to go, not light. So, in fact, I'm trying to think if there was another, Collins was involved in that. I don't think so, because they had their own PTO and everything. So the 1-8 came out. There was a little argument there when Bob Drake kept bugging Milton. Milton liked to operate by himself. He said, look, let me just do what I'm doing, and Bob kept bugging him. Got to the point where they got contentious, and Bob says, well, let me come into my office for a minute. And Milt's thinking, well, and this is in this letter that I got, and he says, well, gee whiz, he says, are you going to fire me? He says, oh, no, I just want to show you, this is what I've done. He shows in his office, and this is the business end of a great company, and this is what I like to do. And he says, I'm not going to bug you anymore, so do what you want to do, and that's what he did. He made the 1A. Well, how are we going to sell this thing? Well, I should have put it up on here. Gibby from Universal Radio. They started in 1946 also in Columbus. You guys heard of Universal Radio? I think his name was Frank Gibbs, something like that. Anyway, he said, I'll give you an order for 100 of them. And what do you think of that? And Bob Drake said, well, that's great. We'll go ahead. And I think that's enough. We can go ahead and make something. If you can sell them, great. And then we'll go into production. And that's what they did. And they start rolling along pretty good. And of course, when the 2A and the 2B came out, they had to make a change because the radio was getting kind of teased about its looks and what have you. And they thought, well, on the 2A, they actually put a selectivity switch here. It's great for AM. If you're into AM, the 2A is a little bit better because it's a little wider. And then the 2B really caught on because of the Q multiplier and the selectivity of that LC network. By the way, they used to make an optional box like this to be used with other radios, 455 IF or 50 KC IF right here. It's a passband tuner, external, that could be used with other radios. Yeah, that's something that's, I figured I had this picture up. This is Milt's favorite radio here. That's just a coffee table at home. And this sideband passband tuner could be used in other radios. Pretty neat, isn't it? And they made a lot of stuff like that prior to, actually, before the 2B and the 1A. And that really was the key. Their coil winding group was in the old carriage house down in 540 Richard Street, Miamisburg, south of Dayton. And they had all these coils and all these, everything was made themselves. Most all this was produced themselves. At one time they did their own power transformers, but these were produced in Cincinnati by Syntran Corporation. But they didn't just, Milt Sullivan didn't just say, well, we want this such and so transformer, like from Hammond Industries or from this company. I'm going to tell you what we want and what it's going to cost. And I'm going to calculate, and I've got calculations. You'll see a few of the things up here. I want to calculate how much the core cost, how much the wires cost, and they built around the cost of every little item, like this, the cost of this transformer. What does it cost us to plate this? And by the way, there are three different plating companies that did the plating for it. So every little detail was engineered into this radio, for example, this R4A. And this really got them, the TR3 was really the thing that got them moving, the Drake TR3, because it was compact, small, put out 100 and some, 300 watt input, but put out more than a KWM2. And it was inexpensive to produce, a little less than a KWM2, and it was stable. The PTO was designed with 10. Like I said, still 10 of the little ferrites, and they struggled with that. I think that was, I'm trying to think of his name, it's in the book. They struggled with that, but they finally got it working. Metcalf, I think, Ron Metcalf, I think that was his name. He finally got the PTO, and they made about this is a tube type PTO. The tube is right here, and there's a little coil there, tuned for max output. About 1 volt peak to peak out of that VFO, and then it goes into a premixer, which was neat engineering at the time. That eliminates a lot of hassle, and it gets you one injection voltage from the receiver to the transmitter, vice versa. And they actually switch the as long as we got the receiver here, they actually switch this. This has been changed. That's a 6HS6. The early one was some other kind of tube, I can't remember. They actually turn on the screen voltage, and you'll see a diode in there called D5. If you ever lose your drive, that D5 is open. And for transceiver, they run about a minus 30 volts from the transmitter to the receiver to turn that tube on and off. And that's why the transceiver switch is on the transmitter. So they run that voltage inside, superimpose that voltage on that injection cable. So there's AC and DC sitting on there.
From the transmitter,
right? Yeah. So you don't want to be shorting out that injection cable. That's something across the floor there. Maybe we got bugs too. Here's Milt Sullivan and Ron Wasong. Ron Wasong, actually, he was president for a short time at the end. He came up with the C4 concept. That was his idea, and nobody touched it. But anyway, that was him. And Bill Frost and Joe Brunzo, I think that's a Zio instead of an S. So anyway, they set up the equipment here for that display at their office. I think as you walked into the office of 540 Richards, that was on the right side. That was the file box. That's my shack. This is the file box that came in from Milt's wife. Came in UPS, and let me tell you, that was heavy. But it was packed well. Really was. There's that amplifier I was telling you about the other day. I talked about Paul from Palstar. That's a prototype amplifier, single 3500. By the way, that's a 60-pound amplifier, single tube, built like a tank. Here's some of the notes, and they're in this order, and I want to keep them in this order, so everyone will come out one at a time. And you notice a lot of stuff here. Here's an MN7500. Oh, you guys ever hear of an MN7500? Well, it had two roller inductors. You'll see down the road. An inexpensive 500-watt tuner called an MN75. And the one that you'll see Alpha Delta. Well, I kind of spilled the beans here, but what I wanted you to see is QRP transmitter that they were working on. Well, the QRP transmitter file, that's his writing, was a big style amplifier. With lots of notes from manufacturers. Svetlana was number one. Ceramic tube amplifier, big one. And he had been working on that for quite a while, apparently, because there's a lot of notes on that. You can see all the, he had all kinds of notes from ham radio magazines and what have you. Svetlana sent him all kinds of information. Their basic engineering practices were to start from a clean start, don't try to copy anybody else, using few parts without compromise. That's hard to do, but boy, if you can do it and pull it off, you're doing good. Calculating all costs, like I told you about the transformer net, extensive pre-testing of all the components. For example, in 77, they were building the TR-4s, and a lot of solid-state stuff was in it, 2 and 3904s, what have you, and they were kind of evolving into solid-state at that time. Every one was tested prior to even getting onto the board. And the ones that weren't went into a big bag, and that big bag would end up over at Radio Shack, and those 10 packs of 2 and 3904s, 2 and 3906s. They didn't meet spec. And by the way, there's other manufacturers there in the U.S. That do the same thing. If we make everything ourselves, now this is some of the early notes. They had, eventually, like transformers, had to go to Syntran. But I never saw a bad transformer from Syntran yet. Not from manufacturing, anyway. AC4 supply, AC3, L4B supply, never a bad transformer yet. Finished product had to fit within our machinery, tools, and production line. That's why the L4B is the size it is. It can't be any bigger because it won't fit the machine when they stamp the cabinets. And that all came down on a big press, put the holes in, folded it again, and put the little edge on the inside all at once. It was just amazing. The following was made from nothing from them. In the beginning, they made their own PTO, which they still made. Crystal filter, the soup can filter, until they went to Bob Tedford from Cincinnati and made the replacement filter for the TR-3 and then the TR-4, Then they went to Network Sciences. They just couldn't make them anymore. Not an 8-pro filter. The passband tuner, their own cabinets, and they did not do their own painting. They sent it out to Hartzell. This I just found recently. This is his lightning calculator. First I thought lightning. Well, it's inductance, capacitance, frequency for tuned circuits. This is the good one. The used, well-used one, I have that also. It's well-used. It's an inductance, capacitance, and frequency calculator from UWL. 1932. Isn't that amazing? So he kept that and he used it along with Smith charts. Here's an example of the T4X, TR4 inductance values. Everything was all hand-done. All these calculations, I got papers on top of papers of all different calculations. That famous band switch you had there, Lynn, there you go, that's probably the one that you had to have. But he calculated everything. Here's the R4C bandpass filter response. This is really interesting how all that was all hand calculated. All kinds of notes. Losses. And this is all done by hand. It's not just, you know, out of the blue. Here's the main relay for the TR4C and the handwritten note. I wish there were some dates on this, but I'll have to look. There may be a date on this one here, and it'll be done on the right side. But everything was all done by hand. Calculations of the breakdown voltages, they were real, they wanted to make sure everything was going to work either into a 10 to 1 SWR or whatever. All their tuners had to meet at least 10 to 1 SWR. And these are some of the breakdown voltages that he calculated everything out. It's just amazing what he did. Switch breakdowns, and we'll go on later here and you'll see, here's the L7 tank circuit, how it was laid out, even the way the switches were and everything, all the different degrees, my network notes, everything was calculated. It wasn't just like throw a coil in here, put a tap on it, and that's going to work. Just all the calculations were just amazing. The Q of the circuit, and that's another reason that guys will say, well, the L4B didn't have 4,000 volts on the Fair 3500s. Well, the cost of the transformer, the size of the tank circuit, it would all have to be recalculated. So when the guys put 4,000 volts on an L4, the Q is all out the window. All these calculations are off. Is it a plate voltage and a plate current? Here's transformer. Here's your cost for the transformer. For example, on the power supply for the Drake 7 line, the total price should be $250, I think it was, and for the L7 transformer. Oh, this is it, $1.55. Cost of the core, 12 something, and the core of the copper, 12 cents and 14 cents. Get it all calculated out. Then he would present that to Simtrans, say, can you make it for this price? He would calculate, already have it pre-calculated out. Pretty amazing. Plate choke specs, particularly for self-resonance, so they don't self-resonate. All that was done. L4B out-of-band specs. You remember, work was coming up, work 79, so they actually had recalculated everything for out-of-band. TR7 being a solid-state radio, no tune. It's critical about all the effects on power, obviously. And you calculated everything out. This is just one of many sheets. Got hundreds of sheets in there. Cooling fan specs. Well, did you just put a Rotron muffin fan on there? No, he calculated everything out and what the cost was going to be for a fan. Then they would have a fan made for them. Here's their tuner. This is a dual roller and tuner, inductor tuner. Contrary to what they used to make, the MN2000 and 2700. And they had plans of bringing this thing out. In fact, I have a letter written by Ron Wason to the engineers and dealers. We've got to get rid of these MN2700s because they're going to come. They didn't say they were going to come out with it, but that's what they were working on. Here's the Smith chart for the 7500, 1981. He's still working there. And he has tons of these Smith charts. Does anybody? I don't know how to read one myself, but that's amazing. He's got tons of these things. And all the everything calculated out. Even the, how do you like the turns ratio here? Looks like the R4C dial, doesn't it, with all the gears? This is the roller inductor deal there. How many turns, ratios and all that, calculated all that out. This is just one of many companies he used, Merch, and I have a couple others in there. Their little 500 watt tuner was going to be economy model, $170 retail. He calculated everything out as far as cost. And he stayed on. He did some, taught some engineering at Brighton University, Wright State, here in Dayton. And of course, him and Don Tyrell. Don Tyrell was W8AD, obviously, Alpha Delta. That's his call. So W8AD is Don Tyrell, who was marketing manager at the time during the four line, late four line TR4CW. In fact, I think that was one of his things, the CW, CWRIT. And him and Milt were real good friends. So Milt went to work for Alpha Delta and designed the Alpha Delta switches and a lot of their products, which you'll see here. So I know it's not Drake, but I figured, well, we'll keep going on as long as he retired and kept working. And he kept working for Drake, too, doing consulting. Had the actual blueprint. And there's one of the blueprints copied here of the famous four-position switch, which they still make today. And he had calculations of all the different losses in the switch as it went around. That roller goes around. It's pretty critical. And there's a lot of copies out there, but not quite the same. And by the way, they're made in Kentucky. The casting and everything's all made in Kentucky. And this is the notes from the Alpha Delta group. He also designed something else that kind of looks familiar. Remember that speaker on the right? Everybody knows about this. So he made it similar to that. What it is a more modern speaker with a 5-watt chip. One of those with the big fancy wings on it and running. And it was it had notch filter, low pass and high pass, band pass. And it worked pretty good. It had a few perps and beeps when you turned it on, but it did work. I had one for a long time and it really did work well. But ironically, it certainly looks similar to a 2BQ or something. And there's the hand drawing of it, of the VRC unit. And the chip was, I'm trying to remember what kind of chip it was, but it was big. And it was about 5 watts of audio. Shortwave listeners did like it at the time. Well, they sold a lot of them. Here's your low and high pass filter calculations. Again, everything detailed, even to the speaker. And watch this one. He would even calculate dB level versus frequency, not just guessing. So he wouldn't just throw a speaker and he wanted to calculate at 60 cycles how many dB output it was all the way through. And he did this all by hand. Just amazing. He did the transorbs, designed that, and made Don Tyrell a lot of money in VSWR measurements for TransTech. And unfortunately, I found out when Judy called me to talk about his files, what to do with them. She wanted me to have them, and I said, well, what about publishing? And she said, well, she says, I just want you to have them. You know what to do with them. I said, well, okay. And I don't think she, they wanted to throw them out. And her son was an engineer also, one of the sons. And he certainly hit home with me, I'll tell you that. And here's the Drake Museum that you see as today. This is at the VOA. This was in the Drake office. Now it's at the VOA, Voice of America. We'll see it there. And we've got to thank Bob Drake. Look at all the stuff that they made. Just amazing. From here all the way through, all this stuff. And there's their satellite stuff in the 80s. Bill Frost told me in 1980s, they had, I think, 2 shifts at 8 hours each, 100 people working constant. And they could have used more hours or more people. They just couldn't keep up. And that was in the heyday. I also have a few things here. You have a little bit of time yet? We don't want to put anybody to sleep yet. Skipping IF filters, I'll just touch on this. Kind of neat, I got a Regal Spectrum Analyzer, and boy, it's a pretty nice little box for the money, can't beat it. And Siglent's another one. I'm using that on the receiver for LC and crystal filters. I'll give you some quick deals here. R4B. Well, that's a digital readout that RAC used to make in Franklin, Pennsylvania. He doesn't make them anymore. That's a nice chip that drives it. So real nice. You can preset up the 5 frequencies in there and program them for the offset. And you can do it to 16 externally. Somebody like Bob could come up with something like that. There you go, Bob. There you go. What's that?
That's a one.
Yeah. 50 KC IF here on the 4 line, the R4. We're going to sweep this, and we're going to sweep this. So here's what the 50 KC can look like. This is actually not bad, but a lot of these come in the 400, 1.2, and 2.4. Of course, you can go to 4.8, but I can only do three sweeps at once to show it once. At the 6 dB points here, you can see how lopsided it is. And this was done with the alignment per the manual, where you put it in narrow mode, and you hope to God that it comes out straight. Well, it didn't quite come out straight, and after I swept it, and this actually is probably better than that, but I didn't have the bandwidth correct, but it did make a big difference. And that's those little springs in the back of the L4 or the R4. They are a little touchy, but this is what you can do. And the 2B is the same way, but it's hard to get at. The R4B is great, R4A. Makes a big difference.
And
here's the roofing filter, right there. A lot of them have a badge along the side here or on top. It's a two-pole filter, two crystals in there. If you peek it like the factory tells you, it's going to look like this on the outside. Nice peak. But if you sweep it, you can flatten that out, so you lose about a dB or so. But look, you bring in the skirts. It does make a difference. You can actually squeeze that in, and it's just ever so slight. Just amazing. So that goes to show you what that little tweaking will do. Here's the R4C, which of course has crystal filters. And the difference there is, it's really a completely different radio, but it does use the premixer, like Bob had mentioned before. Simple injection right here at the first IF. They use a four-pole crystal filter, mix it again, and then they use these crystal filters that are eight-pole. On it right here. And also, this is what they look like when they're swept next to each other. You can see the difference. They are sharper. But they sound a little sharper too, because of the not quite rounded edges here. Nice smooth edges here. But they do work. And here's the four-pole filter mounted here. It's BZO 8 KC wide at 5645. And this would be basically the difference here. A little more flatter response, a little steeper skirts, and an improvement, especially if you're a DX or a contester and all that. Here's your filter matching on the TR4s, for example, those two coils. And it's T13, a single tweak on the bottom, and one here. And you want to try to even them out for both sidebands. And this is what the radio looked like when I first, before I tweaked on it. And this is after I swept it and tweaked L6, T6 and T13. Okay, that's lower sideband. Here's the upper sideband.
Is that an IF sweep?
No, that was actually done with a audio sweep generator right in the mic. So now you're going through the balance modulator, you're going through just like you're talking into it. And that I find to be the best way. Really works, Swan, and a lot of the radios that anything with a high Q, because that's a real, those are real high, this is real high Q here. The filters are mounted right here. On the TR3 and the TR4, they're underneath, and there's no chassis modifications. By the way, there's high voltage up here on these resistors. They use these big resistors. They like to use resistors.
What's the voltage level you have going on?
Just audio, normal audio. I just dump it in until like, and the other thing is on an AC4 supply, there's an ALC jack, and you look at minus zero to about minus 4 volts. As you're talking in the mic, you can actually see that on a nice VTVM. I use a VTVM for everything. And what you can do is actually bring the mic gain up until you see about a minus 2 voltage, and you'll see it. So it's sitting in the middle of the range here, between 0 and 4 volts. And you can tweak for maximum on that also with a sweep generator. We'll just tweak it until that ALC is... Okay, now here's up until it... you see it on the spectrum analyzer or an SDR receiver. Here's a 2-point wide filter versus the INRAD filters you can still get. That's what they look like. And this is what they look like before and after. So this is a little bit lower, depends on where you set your carrier set point, but basically you can stretch it out a little bit. It does mellow out the radio a little bit, but you also have a little more QRM on the receiver. But it is an improvement. And here's the imported sideband filters versus the network science filters, and you can look at these skirts coming down. The Network Science American-made filters are a little bit sharper down here at the low end. This is where Swan was really good at, because Herb Johnson knew how to make filters, and he had the filters specced out at 2.7 across the top, with really steep skirts, even steeper than Drake's. They would come way down here at 60D. He would rate his at minus 120. Really steep skirts. You have an SS16 filter and a Swan. Don't even think about running AM because you're never going to get it. And because the skirts are so darn steep. But for QRM, it's great. And the sideband quality is still the same because it's still flat across the top here. But I just thought you'd be interested to see what a network science, oops, keeping on a battery. INRAD, they're pretty good, but not as good as the network science and also the standard Japan filter that they have on a TR7. And what else is there? Oh, that's it. Any questions? Yes.
I'm just amazed at how much work went into these things. What kind of a profit margin did they have?
Well, very little profit margin. That was a problem. You know, like a lot of companies, I don't know, I'm sure West Shum had the same thing. You know, you're working with a very, when I worked at Amateur Electronics, our margin was about 20 to 25%. And he talked about being paid, so the manufacturer, Drake, was waiting for money. Well, Terry Sturman, that owned AES at the time, he always paid within 5 days. He was one of the few distributors that would pay, so he would get another 5% off. Because Bob Drake knew, or anybody, and the Japanese loved him because, oh yeah, we bought money now. Yeah, and they just loved it. Because he would pay in 5 days, so they give another 5%. And of course, they would buy in big volume also. But the margins, because now the hams wanted a 15% discount right away. Plus, they wanted big money for their trade. Very little money. They had to make a lot of it, and they didn't make a lot. Drake would make L4Bs twice a year. They would make TR4s maybe 4 times a year, T4Xs 4 times a year. So they would make them for like that week. They'd make a whole ton of them. We would wait for a long time for L4B linears. You want a C-line? Well, we got receivers, but we don't have transmitters. When are you going to make? Well, next week I think we're going to make some transmitters. And they would maybe make a half a dozen to a dozen a day. But now that had to be spread around the whole world. A lot of labor involved. And to see a TR-4 being assembled, it's just amazing. That was the hardest radio for Drake to make, and then try to QC and get it out the door. And what would happen, I was there when they had a TR-4 sheet come off the line at the end. I went there in the morning, I remember, it's March of 77, and Susie, the QC gal, real big gal, Drake had their own test meters and everything. They made everything themselves, all their test jigs and all that. And something didn't check out on the old meter. Big meter. Looked like a big Heath kit, big 6-inch meters. Remember that big Heath kit meter you used to see? Yeah, something like that at the end of the line. And she'd take the radio and take it over to Martha over here that was supposed to be in charge of that particular. She'd know where the problem was. And she had to fix it so the line would stop. The whole line. Now, Bob Drake was around. He happened to see no activity. All right, what's happening? You know. On the other hand, Bob Drake, if he had an employee sick, like a woman that was written in the book, was sick, and or anybody was sick, or something happened to a family, he would personally go to the house and say, what can I do to help you? That's how he was. So that was pretty good about Bob Drake. Yeah. Really amazing. And Milt Sullivan, boy, I tell you, him and Bob Drake, they got along great. After that discussion about getting out of my way, because you're in my way, Milt Sullivan was doing something. Bob Drake says, I'll just run the business. How's that sound? He says, okay. Work for them. Any other questions? Okay, that was quick. Yeah. It's, I figured you guys would like that. And if you want to see the box, I can get out of the car. If you guys want to go through the paper. Thank you.
You guys take a little stretch right now.